So welcome to this talk about Prometheus and more specifically how to monitor your CentOS stack. So it will be a general introduction to Prometheus but a bit more focused on systems administration. In the meantime, I'm trying to bootstrap an OpenShift cluster which might or might not work. I work in Belgium in the open source field, so many of you will know me. I'm working almost full-time on monitoring now, and I'm using Prometheus to provide insight of big systems in Belgium regarding healthcare currently. So I'm doing pretty deep into Prometheus. I work for Enwix, which is an open source consultancy company in Belgium, so if you need us or in Europe, just call us, we will help you. So usually this is admin. When they think about monitoring, they think about the disk is full, I don't have any zombie processes, I don't have 100 users connected to my machine, SSH works, which means yeah, the SSH daemon is giving me something. Or the swap is empty, but it's no longer the case now, it's no longer what is monitoring nowadays, because the real question now is, okay, it's up, but is it performant? So is it working fine? Do I need more servers, less servers? What can I do to improve my performance? Or, okay, I have an issue that disk is full. What is the impact on my actual customer? Like, because the customer will not call you and tell you, yeah, your disk is full. They will call you, they will tell you, yeah, the website is not working. So just having a high number of zombie processes or having a disk which is full, maybe it's not worth it to wake you up at night because of that. Also, it is not all red, all green. You have a service and sometimes you can serve 95% of the requests. And if you have a monitoring that will just tell you red or green, then you don't really know what is the actual impact. And that's one of the first things that you need to know in order to know the priority of the incident. If someone is telling you the website is not working, then you need to know, is it just that person that maybe has a bad Wi-Fi connection, or is it all my users that are impacted? So that's very important. And that's where matrix monitoring came in. So it started with tools like Graphite, and then people started to say, okay, I will get metrics, I will just put them in a metrics database. And then we can get a lot of data, a lot of metrics, but still it was next to the monitoring solution. Like, it was a second-hand monitoring solution. When you had really issues, you would look at the graph file, but it's still the old Lagios or Kinga that will do the alert. So what's important with metrics is that you have them, you can analyze them, you have a lot of information, and you should start from that to do your alerting. So it's really part of the monitoring, it's not all of it, but it's not worth it to keep a traditional monitoring stack if you go far enough in the monitoring, metrics monitoring. And then you can alert directly for your metrics and not only rely on tools like Nagios, Kinga, and 0 and 1, that kind of things. When I say that it's part of the monitoring, it's because it is the basic of the monitoring nowadays. And when you don't have enough with metrics, then you have a look at the logs that will tell you exactly for specific issues, the logs of the application, the logs of the servers. And when you want to go further, then you look at the spans, which are more in the tracing part of the monitoring. It means that you really look at inside the application what happens for that specific transaction. But that's really for very, very fine-grained issue tracking. So in the cloud, you have all those buzzwords. You have a lot more scale, you have more servers, you have more change, and it changes very fast. And when you have now an infrastructure on-premise, when you have lots of servers, it's the same. Like, nowadays, you don't install CentOS using a DVD on one server. No, you bootstrap 100 servers at a time, or 2, 3, 10. It's not like you will get one server and do everything with it. No, you have lots of VMs, you have lots of change, even on-premise. And it means that the tools that you use should be automated and scalable as well to do your monitoring. They should follow your work and not add more work to what you are doing now. So the tools that did all-in-one or that don't scale You cannot meet them like you need to add a server by clicking on the web UI. You need to forget that, because when you will scale, when you will add all the apps, you will forget stuff, you will not be able to keep up, and then monitoring will be done like tomorrow, which will be too late, because then you will forget about it. There is also the problem that many monitoring tools nowadays, they will check every 5 minutes, is it doing well? And then, but your customers, they ask you to respond like below 1 minute, or they really want you to be like very high on the SLA. You cannot just say, okay, I will just check every 5 minutes, and then you don't see anything because the problem only lasted 3 minutes. So you need to do a lot of things all the time in your monitoring stack to understand what's going on now, and now not 5 minutes ago. So introducing Prometheus. So Prometheus is cloud native. It means it's really simple to deploy. It works in all the environments, and you can put it in containers as well. Data-centric, what does it mean? It means that with Prometheus, what is important is the data. So you will have a lot of numbers, but it is not just numbers, it is a number with different dimensions. Like you will have the size of the disk with the path of the disk. You will have, in this case, a MySQL command, and then you will know which handler is beside that command. So you have numbers with an extra set of labels, which Graphite did not add in the past. It also means that when Prometheus wants to go and look for metrics somewhere, it doesn't know what it will get. So when you have applications, you will know the port where they will expose the data you want, but you will not know, and you will not be able to tell, okay, give me only that metric. No, it is up to what you are talking to give you the relevant metrics. So you put the power in the developers, you put the power in the outside of the monitoring system itself. So he will go, he will access metrics, and he will get metrics. And then those data, you will filter them, change them, remove them if you don't need them when you get them, but basically you don't really know what you will get. It's fully open source, Apache 2.0, it's written in Golang, and you can run it on a lot of different operating systems. It is still expected that it is using POSIX compliant storage and not NFS, and not so on Windows, that kind of thing. It will run, but not recommended for production. And then you have a lot of exporters, which we will see later. Prometheus is also, you need to think, one service will do one thing. It means that you will not have just Prometheus, you will have the exporter, if you want alerting, you will need another tool. So it's simple because it's all small pieces, and then you can update each piece whenever you want. So for sysadmin, it's really easy to do. It also has a database because you need to store metrics over time, but as a sysadmin, you don't need to take care about it. Prometheus will clean it, it will remove the old entries. You have time-based retention, like I want to keep 30 days, or disk-based retention, I want to keep 10 gigs of metrics. And then that's it. You don't need to know about the internal of the database. So for CentOS, you have RPM, so if you want to build it yourself, to deploy it with RPM, you can use two different kind of spec files. You have the first one, which is the Red Hat spec file for OpenShift, that will build Prometheus in a correct way. And we have the second one, which is the one that I'm using, which just take what's on GitHub in the Prometheus releases and puts it into RPM. You have advantages, like you have the systemd file, all that stuff extra in the RPM. So how is Prometheus working? And then I will start the demo. So let's say you have a MySQL service. MySQL does not expose Prometheus metrics, which is just a text HTML page. So you add next to the MySQL something that is called an exporter. In this case, the MySQL exporter. In Prometheus we go, you will go to the MySQL exporter and say, hey, give me your metrics using the HTTP protocol. MySQL, the exporter, will say, okay, I will do the SQL queries to MySQL to get the data I want, and then it will give the metrics to Prometheus back. And then Prometheus will store the metrics with additional metadata into its database. So, if I know, my OpenShift has started. So that's good, I guess. So, first I will install Prometheus on my machine and I will show you exactly how this is working. So, I did take the Prometheus from the website. I extract it. And all I need to do now is to launch it, the Prometheus binary. And now I can open my web browser. So this is the Prometheus web interface. It doesn't look sexy, it doesn't look anything. It's just a very simple interface. You put a query there and then you will get your answer. Let's maybe start with the list of the targets. So in this case, Prometheus, when you start it, it is configured to monitor itself. So the Prometheus server is exposing some metrics that you can access using the slash metrics. So now if in my URL I put slash metrics. So this is what metrics looks like in Prometheus. What could I like? If you want to know the number of threads that Prometheus is using now, you can just look at this and it will show you, okay, Go threads 20. It's very easy. Any software that can expose HTML can expose Prometheus metrics out of the box. It's just an HTML page. It's easy to debug. So I can just do a curl in my console and I will get the same result. And I have a lot of metrics. I don't know how much exactly, but I have lots of metrics and if I will use them or not, that's not important now. What I have seen is that we collect lots of metrics and then suddenly we have an issue in production. And then you realize, okay, oh, but that metrics show us the problem. We didn't have it anywhere in a graph or in an alert, but because we have the metrics, then we could see in the past how many times it has happened before, or when it will happen again, or how many servers are impacted before they actually have the issue. So you can actually, by collecting lots of metrics, guess what will happen next and when it did happen in the past. So you will collect a lot of metrics that you will not actually use, but that is completely fine. So you have those metrics, and then you are back in your Prometheus server. And then you can just query them, like the number of threads. You just type the number, the metric you wanted to see, and here you have it. The graph will show you how it did evolve in the past. In this case, it went from 19 to 20, which is not exceptional. So that's a very basic Prometheus query. If I now add a second Prometheus server, then I will see the two of them. So if I just try it. I will just copy that directory. And then I will launch a second Prometheus server on a different port.
You did CD instead of CD.
Oh yes. Still not happy. I will just put 2. Okay, I will just delete the data and I will check now how to change the ports. So I will launch another one, but I need to use another port. Okay, it is not helping me. Okay, so that one. I will go to my first one and I will change the configuration to tell him that there is another one. So Prometheus is configured using YAML files like every DevOps tool. So you have the script interval by default, it's 15 seconds.
Well,
they say the default is 1 minute, but they put the default config file with 15 seconds. And then I will see that I have a job called Prometheus with a list of targets, and I will just add the 9191 that I have created now. Localhost, colon 9191. I will reload the configuration. And hopefully now, in my list of targets, I will see, okay, I see the second one as well, and now I will be able to see the trace of the two Prometheus servers. Okay, 20 and 70. So you can see that by default Prometheus has added to my go trace value two extra labels. The instance, which is the address of the target, and the job, which is the job in the configuration. So usually you will have one job per application, and then you will have extra labels. You can add labels directly when you expose the metric, but you can also add them at the Prometheus level. What you usually add is, for example, the environment is something that you will add at the Prometheus server level, like that target is a dev target, that target is a prod target. So now I have my Prometheus server, I have a lot of metrics and I can see all of them. Some metrics are there for information like the version of Golang that was used to build the Prometheus server, which is helpful, for example, when you need to upgrade your Go version or in Java, when you want to check which JVM is running in your whole cluster, you just have one metric and it will show you all the information. So now I have that data, like the Go version. I can now do stuff like counting the value of the labels. So if I want to know how many Go versions are running on my environment, I can say count Go info and then by version, for example. And then it will tell me, okay, you have two Go systems that have been built with Go 1.11.5, because it says the version and then the value. If I go now back, it is my second one, okay. I probably have an old one. I will start an older Prometheus. 2.3.1. Okay, and I will launch it. And now if I rerun that, first of all, I have seen that the first one was done, so now I just have one metric. But soon, okay, so now I see that in my environment, I have one version 1.11.5 and 1.10.3. I guess the Go threads also will be different. So Go threads is giving me now different version, so I will make it up. That's 15 minutes, then you see, okay, I had 17 threads when I booted the first one, and it goes up to 19, and now 20 and 21, okay. Never mind, it's not really an important metric. So you can do a lot of stuff, so averages, maximums, all that kind of thing can be done with the PromQL. I will show it more later. Now, when you monitor a server, you might know it, but in the past, the Linux kernel did have an embedded HTTP server, which is no longer the case since 2.6. So you need something to expose metrics. But when do you get metrics in Linux? It's mainly in the slash proc file system. So we will get the node exporter, which is actually the way to get metrics on the systems. So the node exporter is an exporter that will connect to Linux-like systems and it will look in slash proc and expose metrics about CPU, disk usage, network. So if I go there and I launch it, 9100. So I will again edit my configuration. And I will tell him, okay, I have a new job, which is called node. it is OTM. So I add a new job, which I will call node, and I have one in, one line in red, and I just have one. But maybe I might have another one later, so I will just have one just now. Just so I can show you more stuff. So now, I reload the configuration. When Prometheus is getting information about a node, it will create a metric called up. So now, if I just do up, I should see four different stuff. And up is one very basic metric that on Prometheus that says I could get the metrics or I could not get the metrics. So you see that the one that I invented is zero, but the other one is one. So now I should have a lot of stuff, a lot of metrics coming from my laptop. How can I show them? The easiest way is to do this. Just I want to filter on that instance and that job. I don't put a metric name, I don't put anything, and I just execute. So now I have like a bit more metrics again. So if I go on the top, I will see exactly how much. 800 metrics. What is interesting there? First of all, you have the CPU usage. You have it for each CPU, for each mode. It means that if you add or remove CPU, it will also be adapted in the metrics. You have the disk, I/O, the disk merge. That is important because you can then see the performance of your disk. You have the disk space, so this is the disk space, and you also see everything related to every mounted file system. It's important because I did not say in advance to Prometheus, hey, look at that file system, that file system, that file system. No, it has taken the metrics of all my file system. If I mount a new one, if I unmount one, it doesn't care. It will add or remove the metrics. So that's really good to be able to see that. So let's try to do something with the file system, or maybe the network will be more interesting. So we have the network. Let me find one that will tell me, okay, the bytes that I have received, like this. So I have a few interfaces on my laptop, and I have a node network receive total bytes. Okay, so as you can see, it is not helpful. I mean, I don't really care that my type 1 interface has got that many bytes. It is not important. But what I want to know is how many bytes I have received. So then I need to apply a function on Prometheus. So the idea is that when you are an exporter, when you are an application, you don't want to pre-calculate the metrics. You want to just give the metrics in a raw format, and then Prometheus will do the extra work. Like if I now do the rate, like this, over 5 minutes, then I will see, okay, oh, I am using my my network. I will maybe put less than 5 minutes, because, okay. So you see, suddenly I have started downloading stuff on the device tap one and my wireless device. So the idea that you just put raw metrics and then Prometheus will do the extra calculation is very important when you develop your own applications, because you want to minimize the monitoring footprint, so you don't need to monitor the rate. It also means that if tomorrow I want to say, okay, I don't want the 1 minute rate, but the 1 hour rate, you will be able to do it. You don't need to decide now the rate that you want to see. And if you add a new interface, you don't have to do anything. It will just magically appear. And it's the same for all the applications, because all you give to Prometheus is, okay, go to that URL, go to localhost 4900, and then get the metrics, and that's it. So, the node exporter has another nice feature, is that when you have a cron job that is running, when you have that kind of thing, when you have metrics that you don't know, you are not all Go developers, you don't want to write your exporter, so it can also collect from a file. So if you can just write a file, like this, and you just want to see, okay, I don't know, RPM updated one, I don't know. So that when you do a YUM update at night in a cron job, then you can write 1 or 0 if it has worked or not. You can tell the node exporter, hey, please check that directory and take that metric into consideration. I will not demo that, but this is just as easy as this gets. There is a problem with that, a small problem, which is that when you do that, then you need to have the write to that directory, which is not always the case, because if you want a cron job as a normal user, you maybe don't want anyone to be able to write to the Prometheus directory. So you have an alternative to that, which is the pushkit, which I use also quite a lot. So I do write a lot into files. So to show you an example of what I'm doing, I have that directly from production, that file, which is just like an RPM command that will query everything in a format that looks like Prometheus, with a dash query format of RPM. I do some grep because I am only interested in some packages and I put that into the rpm.prom directory. I also add a timestamp, which in recent version is not needed because now you see the timestamp of the file as metrics in Prometheus, but I still have it. I put the duration of the script. And at the end, I move the file rpm.prom.tmt to rpm.prom. So that script is showing me, okay, when I did install which package. It's very easy. Maybe I could have written that in Yum, but I'm a sysadmin and sometimes I take the easy way. So by doing that, I'm able to track the version changes in my infrastructure of some rpms. The alternative to that is the push gateway. I don't know if there is an example. So, push gateway. I will not edit the binary. So the push gateway is like, okay, I want to add metrics in Prometheus from a batch that runs at night, but it does not last enough so that I can tell Prometheus, hey, look at that URL, take the metrics, because it will die at any moment, it will not last a long time. So I can just use the push gateway. 1991. You see, by default, there are no metrics. Maybe if I do slash metrics, I will still see the Go metrics of the push gateway itself, but not my actual metric. Now that I know that, let's see how to do a simple curl to put my actual RPM updated metric, for example. Yeah, like this. Okay. So, CD demo. So I take my metric, and that curl should just work. 1991 slash metrics, and then I need to add some extra labels like the job. Job RPM update. Okay. I need a pipe. So now if I go to my push gateway, like this, I should have my RPM update. So I see RPM update 1, I did not add an instance, so it is empty, but my metric is there. And I can also see that there, like, I have a job, and then I have those two values, so when I pushed, and the actual metrics. And if I update it now, then it is overwritten. If I now change my metric, I will put 0, it will go to 0, One extra thing is that if you have long batches, then you might do something like FM-updated and then just do FM-updated finish, I don't know. Yes. And then you can just put it, and if you put it, then you will, it will not erase. It should not erase the data. In this case, it did, I don't know why. Okay, in theory, it should not. I will read the documentation again. Okay, so that was for the push gateway. But the real advantage of Prometheus is also when you start working in the cloud and when you can use service discovery. So you have console, Zookeeper, you have Kubernetes, all of them, they know your infrastructure, because if your node is not in console, it will not get traffic from the load balancer. If your pod is not known by Kubernetes, you have other troubles than monitoring. So Prometheus will go to the heart of the systems and it will directly like be able to understand what is going on. So let me try to find my OpenShift cluster, okay. It is over there, okay. Okay, so so let me log into my OpenShift. I need to find my URL. Mini shift URL. Okay. So I log into my OpenShift, I set my project to be default. And then I will install Prometheus first. So how do I install Prometheus? I just put the YAML file so in the Kubernetes. And in this case, I want Prometheus 2.7, and I want also the configuration. So the configuration, instead of a static configuration, is a Kubernetes SD configuration, and it will look for the pods. So I'm just asking to Prometheus, okay, look, what are the pods in my cluster? And then I will look at some metadata that Kubernetes will give me. So Kubernetes will provide me a lot of different metadata on my pods, because I need to be able to identify them. And I will tell it, okay, look at the port name, and if the port name is Prometheus, then you keep the target. Then I know I will need that pod, I will need to monitor that pod. And then I do some extra magic to add the labels of Kubernetes as labels on my job. Then I expose the Prometheus service so I can actually access it. And I do some extra magic to create an account for Prometheus. So now if I apply it, okay, I need to do some extra magic because the YAML does not work alone, I don't know why. It is the two. So I need to say, okay, that Prometheus user is a cluster reader, so it can access the cluster information, it can read the pods. So now if I you see status. Okay. So I have my Prometheus server, which is not working because it looks like it is downloading very slowly. Okay, now it is working. If I go to service discovery, I have nothing, but I see that there are 19 pods running, but because no, they don't have the Prometheus port name, they are discarded. You see drop, and you also see all the labels. So I am the service discovery part of Prometheus. So what do I do next? Know that I have Prometheus connected to my Kubernetes cluster, it is running inside. If I add a pod with Prometheus as a port name, it will automatically appear in the target. So if I now go to the target, I have zero ports. So I will deploy. I have taken the alert manager from Prometheus, but you can take anything and just if you have that name Prometheus, which it's not optimized just for the demo, I will add four of them, so I will have four ports. As soon as they will be added into my cluster, they will be monitored by Prometheus automatically. So starting now, I don't touch the Prometheus configuration. I just do say apply. Like this. If I look at the pods, okay, they are creating status in Prometheus, so I guess it is getting them from the internet. And once they will be available, started, then they should appear in that list. Maybe. So. Oh. So here they go, two of them, four of them now. And you don't need to change your configuration, it is fully dynamic. And in this case, the source of information is your Kubernetes cluster, so if that is not correct, then you have a big issue. So it is really close to the actual, it should be the actual source of authentication, of trust. So now let's say that I want to change that, because I need like 10 of them. Guess what will happen? I will just see them appearing there. I will have 10 of them. Here you go. And it is the same when you remove them, of course. So now I just want one. Okay, so they are down. Prometheus has not got. Okay, they start to be down. And at the end, Prometheus will remove them because Kubernetes is telling me, yeah, you know, I remove. And here you go. So your Prometheus server is aware of your deployment, it's aware of your infrastructure, and that's the nicest thing. We are using that also with Ansible, so at the end of our script, you will add a file to the Prometheus server, and Prometheus will scan the files, and you'll see, okay, I need to monitor that target, and also that target. Okay. So you can also do anything with Prometheus. So if you can make a graph with something in Prometheus, you can put an alert with that. It means that if I can see, okay, my disk usage, my network metrics, I can just put an alert. If that threshold is there, then just alert. So the alert manager is responsible for that. It's a second service, which is also developed by the Prometheus team, and that second service will send mails, use HTTP webhooks, use Slack or anything to just alert you. We have a lot of integration internet that you just accept JSON from the Alert Manager and just do anything you want with that. So it is yet other services that will do the actual alerting based on the input from the Alert Manager. So the Alert Manager, his main task is to receive the alert, probe them so that if all the disks are full, you get just one notification. And then it will send them. And it is also the Alert Manager that will do the high availability. It means that the Alert Manager will be in a kind of cluster, and they will receive the alert from all the Prometheus servers, and they will together decide who sends the notification. It means that the Prometheus servers are completely independent, and the Alert Manager are the ones that are in cluster. Okay? Then you have Grafana. So I will not spend a lot of time on Grafana because we don't have a lot of time left, but Grafana is basically the way to graph Prometheus metrics. So that's why the web interface is really simple, because all the cool features, all the stuff that you want to share is mainly on Grafana. So you have lots of things in Grafana dashboard, so if I just want to show you what it looks like, you can just go there and okay, here you see the kind of thing that you can build with Grafana. So you can see, okay, I will put all that data in Grafana, I make nice graphs, and then everyone will see the same thing. So Grafana is the way to put stuff in quality so that they look like great. And it's very used by the Prometheus community. So Prometheus will give you access to a lot of data that you can explore in many ways. You can see trends, deviations, you can calculate a lot of stuff. And what is also important is that you can get technical and business monitoring. It means that in the same system I can see how my Linux system is working or my CentOS system is working. But I can also see like the rate of HTTP requests I get. So I don't need to go to a help stack to make graph in my Kibana. No, you have everything in your Grafana, you see everything, and then you can go deeper and see, okay, here I have a problem, I see the technical cause, I see the impact directly, and I have more than just red and green states. So this is really important. And as I have shown you, you can just use it to monitor a standard CentOS setup. It's very simple, you put the configuration, you put the port, you have your metrics, but you can also put it in your Kubernetes cluster easily. It will even be almost embedded in OpenShift. So you can use it to monitor any stuff. So even if you have a very old infrastructure that you don't use the cloud, that you don't use auto-provisioning, that kind of thing, you can still get a lot of value with Prometheus, and it's very, very simple to set up. So that's it. You have a very rich ecosystem, and that is an old slide. So you have a very rich ecosystem, so if you look for Prometheus exporters, you will have a huge list of stuff that you can monitor with Prometheus. So if you look at the list, we have really a long list of stuff that will support Prometheus metrics, and this part is just the one that will expose metrics out of the box, so you don't need an extra exporter to do it. Okay. So now we have a few minutes for the questions. Yes?
So we have been using Prometheus like in an operation process. We have been using it for a while. The problem I see with Prometheus is different retention, like for example if you want to create data for more than a month, then I don't see where you do it in Prometheus itself. I have used Thanos for some of the extension. Is there a way that you can, or is there something that is going to be done in the future in Prometheus itself, to like you know, have like metrics retention for a while, like you know something like a GCS backend or a S3 backend?
So I will repeat the question. So the question is, what about the long-term storage if I want to keep my metrics for a long time? Currently, what Prometheus is doing is it has an API that can push metrics to somewhere else, and they will not go further than that. So the idea behind Prometheus is they say we are just a monitoring solution. So for operations, you don't need more than 1 month of data, or I don't know. The advantage is that now with the version 2 of Prometheus, you can actually just extend the disk space and it will have no performance impact. So that's already a lot better. So in other case, we keep 100 days of data and we don't have an external store for metrics, but it will not be embedded in Prometheus. You'll always need extra tools next to Prometheus to keep longer than that data. But you can decide. Some people which have less metrics can keep them for multiple years. It's not a problem. Yes?
Where do you run the Prometheus server in a Kubernetes Origin cluster? Was it outside the node or was it containerized inside Kubernetes Origin?
It is containerized inside. Well, you can do both, but it is easy to put it inside. And I would even maybe recommend it to put it like not on the worker node, but maybe next to the master or something like that. So it is closer to the source and it will not be dependent on the other stuff. But yeah, so usually you have for Kubernetes the Prometheus orchestrator that can help you to do that, to set up the Prometheus cluster. So yeah, you can have a look. There are many tools that will help you to set up Prometheus inside OpenShift or Kubernetes. And I know that when Red Hat is providing it, I think it's also in containers in the OpenShift itself. Yeah.
What about IO operations? Is it very, because if you have a lot of metrics and it's going to write a lot, you have a lot of tools, if you write a lot of metrics, it's going to push a lot of parts on your storage or on metrics. What is the effect of
No, it will not. It will not, because it will rely on the file system cache, it will not sync every write. Plus, you also have a write ahead log, so it is not expensive on storage, even if you have lots of metrics. So, we are having now 30k of metrics per second, and we have just standard storage, local storage. Just, you need to have a POSIX compliant file system, because it will rely on file system cache and that kind of thing. So if you don't have a POSIX file system, then you might lose some data when there is a crash or something like that. Well, it does not crash, don't worry. So in the past it could crash, but now they have some memory protection on the queries that you do, so it is more difficult to make it crash. Yes?
Would you be able to use it in a compute cluster, and what would be the price on the compute node of the agent?
I don't know. I it's a very big question. What do you mean by a compute node?
In a cluster where people are doing computation, they generally don't want to have too much overhead brought by the monitoring stuff. So
it is very light. We see some issues in some servers which have some network file systems in the node exporter when it takes more time, but the RAM and the CPU consumption is quite okay. So if you need compute nodes already, you can just try it, and it will depend on what you do, the queries you do. But by itself, Prometheus does not take a lot of resources. But it will depend on your use case, how many people are looking at Grafana, that kind of thing.
Maybe just to comment on the performance part. Prometheus is a very interesting tool because you can chain several Prometheus, and you can actually build a tree of Prometheus instances. So your first level Prometheus reads data from small subset of your servers. Then your second level Prometheus reads data from all the Prometheus of first level, and so on. So you can do very many tricks to increase performance. If you have really huge infrastructure, it's very flexible in that way, so you can choose which metrics to which instance and create a whole hierarchy of Prometheus instances reading each other.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much.